want to sing hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Come on. Every praise is to our God. Come on, let's sing every praise. Every word of worship. Come on, every praise. Every praise is to our God. Let's sing hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Every praise is to our God. Come on, choir, let's sing it. Every praise. Come on. Every praise is to our God. Come on, let's sing it. Hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Every praise is to our God. Come on, let's step it up one time. Every praise. Hallelujah. Come on. Worship it. Every praise is to our God. Come on, let's all sing hallelujah. Come on, choir. Every praise is to our God. Come on, He's our Savior. Let's sing it out. Hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Come on, to our God. Every-
Every praise that we got, don't matter what it is, we should give it to God. Amen. We're going to read out of Psalms 19, 7 through 14. Talking about the Word of God. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandments of the Lord are pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. They are more to be desired than gold. Yeah, more than fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb. Moreover, by them your servants are warned, and in keeping them there is great reward. Who can understand his errors? Cleanse me from secret faults. Keep back your servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then I shall be blameless, and I shall be innocent of great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. We're talking about what the Word of God can do for us. It just told us all. It told us everything. It told us just what the law of the Lord was. It's perfect. It converts. The Word of God is perfect. It converts. The testimony of the Lord is sure. It makes us wise. We're talking about the Word of God. The statutes of the Lord are right. It helps us rejoice. We want to rejoice when we're right, don't we? The commandments of the Lord is pure. It enlightens us because it's pure. The fear of the Lord is clean. It's going to help you endure when you're pure. When you're pure, when you're clean inside. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. It's just like gold, having fine gold or having sweet honeycomb to eat. That's what it's talking about, the Word of God this morning. What's presumptuous sins? Ever thought about that? You know me, I'm going straight to find out what it is, what it's going to say about it. It's saying or doing something without the right to do it. All of us, day by day. You know, when I pray, I say, God, forgive me of the things I didn't even know I said, the things I didn't even know I did. The things, the way I acted that I didn't even realize that I acted. All these faults. The Word of God. That's what we've read about this morning. It tells us all. Let's go to Him in prayer. Father, we love You. We thank You, God, that You give us Your Word, Lord. You've given us Your Word, God, that we would know how to live, Lord. We'd know how to act. How to treat others, Lord, through Your Word. God, you've forgiven us, Lord, of the things that we've done, God. And today, Lord, we just ask you, God, that if there's anything in our lives, God, that shouldn't be there, God, any way we've treated our brother or sister, God, anything that we've said against them, Lord, this week, the faults, God, that we have, God, that we may not even know, God, that we have, God, that somebody else might have seen in us a fault, God. God, we just pray, Lord, for your forgiveness, Lord. We pray, God, that you would cleanse us, Lord. Use us, God, in your work, Father. Use us in your kingdom, God. We love you, Father. We honor you. God, you should have, Father, obedience. And you should have holiness, God, from all worshipers, Lord. I love you, Father. I honor you, God. I know, Father, without you, God, we can't do what we do. I give you praise, God, for the sunshine, Father. I give you praise, God, that you give us this chance, Lord, to come to your house, Lord, and worship you, God. Help us not to take that for granted, Lord, but to do our best, God, to worship you, Father, and to abide by your word, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. We honor you, Father.
lift our hands right now for a moment. And let's honor the presence of our Lord this morning. Let's just lift our hands this morning for a moment. And let's just take a moment and realize how good our God is. I know all across the world this morning the Word of God is being preached. I know that someone today is hearing about the good news of the gospel of Jesus. Somebody today is being saved probably all around the world. Missionaries are preaching in the most remote areas. The Word of God is going forth that people might hear the good news of the gospel. Aren't you glad that you've been privileged? Aren't you glad that you've been blessed? That you could come today in a comfortable church building. But I want you to know there are Christians out there this morning that's been arrested because of their faith. And they're having to find time and a place to pray in a dark holding cell. But I'm telling you today, there are men and women that have been touched by God and that are being touched by God. And I'm here to tell you this morning that our prayers mean something. Our prayers mean something. And I wonder today if we just take a moment and we would go to the Lord in prayer. There are needs among us today. I feel real impressed this morning to encourage you and let you know that what God has done for others, He'll do for you. What God has done in your life, what He's did in your family, He'll do for someone else. I've got calls this morning, people that need desperately, they need prayer, they need a touch, they need a strength. I want us to remember the Wheat family this morning. There's a lot of people today that are in need. I got news this morning that possibly Beth and Chester Wheat's son had been killed last night in an automobile accident. Well, how many knows today that God can comfort and God can touch? I want us to pray this morning. I want us to pray for all the requests, but I want to pray for you this morning. And I want God to hear your prayer and answer your prayer. And I wonder today if there's somebody here that needs a miracle. If you're here this morning, before we pray, they're going to sing this again. They're going to sing a verse and a chorus, and we're going to pray while they're singing, because I want the presence of the Lord here this morning. But if you're here this morning, and we're going to take a moment, if you need a miracle, I want you to just come forward. Would you do that this morning? You say, I need a miracle. I need a miracle. I need a miracle. And we know the miracle worker. Is there anyone else this morning? How about it? If you have a request, let me see by the lifting of your hand. You have a prayer request or a prayer need. We still have some that are in the hospital. We still have many that we're remembering and praying for. And we know God is working and God is going to work. And I want to encourage you to encourage those that are in the hospital. I went by and visited my mom this week, almost every day. I took a video of her, and I'll let you see the video if you want to. That's up to you. But I've never saw my mom like this. One of the most hardest things I've ever had to do, to see my mom like she is. Yeah. Yes. But you know, Tracy, I'm not worried about her, because I know my Redeemer liveth. And I know my God is able to do exceedingly and abundantly and above all that we ask or think. And so if you're here and you need a miracle, I want you to come. If not, I want you to pray for that person beside you. Would you do that while we pray? Come on, sing that this morning. I feel His presence.
Made, I'm laying
You know, some of us has problems that we're trying to solve, but we can't. There's only one way for you to get free from some of the things that you're going through, and that's to let God help you. The happiness that you think is coming from other directions is not coming. There's only one place that you're going to find total peace and joy, and that's in the Lord. That's in the Lord. Hallelujah. That's in the Lord. Father, I love you this morning. Father, I thank you for allowing us to be here, God. That we can assemble together, God, forsaking not the assembling ourselves together. But we understand and realize, God, how powerful the experience is when we come together. And God, we lift up the name of the Lord. We lift up and glorify and praise our Lord and our Savior, our Redeemer. And this morning we've done that in song. In spirit and truth, God, to the best of our ability, we take a moment to praise you and to love you. And pray and ask you, God, for covering through prayer, God, on all the needs of all the requests and situations that people are facing and people are going through. We just pray this morning, God, that your covering would be upon the families that we're praying for and upon the individuals that we're calling out names for. There are those that are still sick, those that are still in the hospital recovering from sickness. There are some here today that recently been in the hospital, but they're here today by faith and they're recovering. You're our healer. You're our deliverer. And all of our faith and all of our trust is in you. And we will continue to pray and believe, to see miracles that we've already saw, God, in the last few days and weeks. And we will continue to believe, God, for people to be saved and people to be healed and people to be uplifted and encouraged. That is such an important prayer that we can pray one for the other and pray without ceasing. And so we do that this morning, God. We pray for the lives of those that have been represented this morning by the lifting of the hands. We pray for them. Yes, Lord. Glory to God. You may be seated. I'm going to ask the ushers to come. Those that are praying or continue to pray. I want to give you an opportunity to give. The Lord's good. How many knows the Lord's good? We want to give something to the Lord this morning. As I said last week, and I can't get this out of my mind, I've thought about it all week, how unique it was for the Spirit to tell me to say that today God wants more than your money or your offering. He wants your heart. He wants your heart. What could you give today that would make a difference in somebody else's life? What could you do today or tomorrow that would indeed touch somebody's life? You know, every time we ask you to give financially, we're asking you to be obedient, and to be a good servant, and to be a good steward. I know that's not taught and preached as it should be, but I believe that that's something we will teach and preach in the future, because giving is very important. How many came with a gift today to give the Lord? You know, we have a pantry ministry. Ever so often people ask us for food, and because of finances, we have food, and we can provide food, and we can provide things that people have need of. Sometimes when we gather that food up and we're taking it to a house or to a location, we get the opportunity to pray over that food. We pray that their bodies will be nourished. We pray that needs will be met. But most of all, we pray the love of God will touch people. One of the unique things about mission work is the faces of the recipient. You that have been on a mission trip, you know when you give out of love, they receive with abundance. It's nothing like giving somebody something that you've got and you can give it. So I want you to give this morning to the Lord. Don't give grudgingly. Don't fuss all the way home about what you did for God. He's never fussed about what He did for us. He's never complained. He gets upset because we don't receive. It breaks His heart because we're not good recipients. But I believe the Lord's got something for you today. And He's already doing great things. Amen. So how many today would join me in giving to the Lord? Not only of our money, but our praise and our worship. Amen. Dennis, would you pray this morning? Over the altar. Yes.
Lord, your honor and your praise, oh God. Touching of a heart, the saving of a soul, dear Lord. I give you praise, honor, Lord.
the Lord. That's the way we raised our kids. We called it passing off. But we was in church. Amen. Isn't God good? I mean, he came because you know the goodness of God. And the mercy of God and the love of God. It's beyond description. You know, we've tried many times to relay that message to people and tell people how good God is, but I've come to realize that really the only way that you can show a person, another person, how good God is by your life, by the way you live. Because words are cheap. You know, we can say one thing, but really do another. We can say one thing and mean something else, and God help us that our talk lines up with our walk. You know, God help us to do that. I want to go right into the Word, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I thank you for being here. Welcome to my Father's house. Next week, you might have saw it in the bulletin, but in case you haven't, next Sunday, Brother Orville Brown would be with us. He's coming in this coming Friday. We'll be picking him up at the airport. He'll be spending almost 9 days with us, and we're excited about it. And we just believe that it'll be an encouraging time in the Lord. We haven't per se lined up a revival, meaning that we're going to bring in a speaker or an evangelist, how we in the past, but we are going to have revival in the sense that next Sunday morning, night service, Brother Orville Brown will be with us. And Brother Orville and I have agreed that we will have services Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday as the Spirit would lead us. So I want to say it that way, and I just think this is a time of seeking and searching for God. And I believe God can use Brother Orville in a mighty way. He doesn't normally do revivals, but he has agreed that, you know, we need to be drawn closer to the Lord. So if you look at it like that, we're given an opportunity next week, not for you to just come sit and listen to the Word, but come and be a part of what God is going to do and hear the Word of God and receive from the Lord, but yet be able to go outside the walls of this church and contribute to those that are outside. And so we encourage you to do that. And we've already passed the word out. We've sent out different sources. Brother Jerry Moss has helped us in different ones to send out words. So we want to encourage you to come. And we know how busy everybody's schedule is, but we know also how important spending some time in the presence of the Lord. And that's what we'll be doing. And we'll be privileged to have a missionary with us beginning next Sunday morning. Brother Orville's a great man of God, and we love him. Y'all love him. I know you've met him. And he'll be leading the choir. He'll be directing the music for us during his stay here. I'm excited. I'm believing God to do mighty, mighty things. And his words to me the other night when I was talking to him was that the Lord must be getting ready to do something great because the devil sure has been fighting me. And I guess that's what a lot of us can say. A lot of us has experienced some trials and troubles. But I tell you what, let's be encouraged. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Let's start there. And let's look at some things this morning as I believe the Lord has given us direction to give you a word that will be a life-changing word this morning. It says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, say, be in Christ. He is a new creature, say, new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. I've been encouraged by several lately to teach and preach more in these lines because it's such an important matter now. It's such an important subject for spiritual growth in our life individually. And in our homes, as you know, as you read reports as I have, you've saw news as I have, you've watched media, you've heard people talk, and you've watched things happen around the world in Alabama as well as other places. And you know that if anything's under attack, it's the family. It's the family, it's the home, and it's the individuals, you know, too. And I want you to understand how the enemy has come up with all the new artillery that he thinks he needs to defeat us. But my Bible tells us that we're more than conquerors. We're overcomers. And I tell people that every week. I have counseled 6 times this week with married couples. Now, you may not can fathom that, and no, they're not all in this church, so don't be trying to figure out who they are. What's important is that somebody like me can tell somebody like them, don't you give up. You put your faith and trust in God, and He'll get you through this. That's what it's all about. You know, it's understanding what 2 Corinthians 5:17, if any man be in Christ, the Bible says he is a new creature. I want to share some things with you that I believe God has given us to share. It's been reported that Americans spend more than $50 million, hear this, a year on subliminal messages or tapes that are designed to help them do everything. Listen to me. People are spending unheard of amounts of money finding answers to problems that one scripture right there can solve. Somebody got to help me this morning, because I'm here to tell you, yes, it's good to go to other sources and other places, but make sure God's at the very top of your list, and make sure that it's God that you're consulting first before you go to anybody else. There are materials out there that's been written by godly men and women that are prayed over and fasted over and has a spiritual anointing on them. I suggest you get them and read them. But if they're something that's going to lead you to a secondary type of thought and lead you away from what the Word of God teaches and preaches, I advise you to stay away from it, because their world is full of advice, and I'm tired of people trying to give advice that hadn't received advice. Somebody help me this morning. You know, I feel like I have a right to tell people that they can make it through their trials, Brother Tim, because I've lived that scripture. That scripture is real in my life. If any man, David Kelly became a new man in Christ. The old man died. The new man is alive. And I can stand with authority this morning and say, yes, I can shine a light on your path and show you where to go and how to get there. Somebody say amen. My Lord, this is teaching, but if it ain't preaching, I guess I'm full. Amen. Somebody help me this morning. Now, $50 million, I read this and I thought, my Lord, what we could do with that on the mission field. $50 million have spent every year, and more than that, this is an average amount that's spent every year by people that are trying to find a message, that's trying to get hope and help. And there it is, right there. There it is. Isn't it amazing that there are people in the world today that will gladly receive advice from you, that would gladly let you give them a good, a romantic novel to read, or some kind of book that might touch the human mind or the interest of a human. But you know, you ever noticed, some of you may have never done this like I have, but I'm a Bible giver. Man, I embarrass people with the Word of God. Not intentionally, because I know I'm not supposed to do anything wrong in that sense, but I know one thing, the greatest gift you can give somebody is God and His Word. How many believe that? And if you put a book like this in the hand of somebody, my blessed God, what can it do just for a moment? Just think about it. I'm reminded of a true story that was told by a man that I happened to be at a prison conference in Atlanta, Georgia, back in the 80s. I remember a story about a man that got saved. He was in a hotel room. Yes, he had a gun. And yes, he was about to end his life. But listen, he opened a drawer, and there was a Gideon Bible. He opened that Bible. Guess where it fell to? John 3:16. He gave his heart to the Lord. Let me tell you, God knows how to talk. God knows how to speak. Woo, I'm glad they put them Bibles out there. Because there's people staying in hotels that won't go to church. Come on now. There's people that wouldn't dare come here to hear the Word of God. But I tell you what, let's make sure we get the word where he can get to them. We, even though they dodge the church, we want them to hear the word. We don't want them to miss the opportunity. But there are $50 million being spent at least every year by people that are looking for improvement or self in their self-image or to overcome personal trials in their life. Think about what an industry there is out there, Brother Shane. People are literally spending 50 plus, probably a lot more than that, millions of dollars every year looking for self-improvement, looking for help that will bring personal gain and prosperity. If you don't believe what I'm saying, go in the bookstore. Go Barnes and Nobles. Go down through the family section and look all the books that's been written about how to save a marriage, how to have a good marriage, how to have a good relationship. There's hundreds of them. And I'm saying there's some good ones out there. I probably got 20 down there at my house that I've read, that I've studied, and I teach these classes. We teach these couples classes. But I'm telling you, there's no book better than this book. Person told me this week, said, hey, whoo, I read Hosea. I got in Hosea, and God got to talking to me about relationship and commitment, and I'm telling you what, he changed my life. Somebody say amen. If you've never read this story, you need to read that story. It's powerful. But think about all the money and all the time people spend looking for happiness, looking for fulfillment, looking for joy. But listen, it's been reported by the National Research Council and Committee out of Washington that subliminal messages simply don't work. Uh-oh. They simply don't deliver the life. They don't give transforming power that they promise. I don't know how many times you read a book or got a book and you read it, man, the cover looked great, the picture looked good, and the heading looked good, but you got into it and you thought, this ain't real interesting. Ooh. You ever got one of them books and read about 20 pages and then it's been laying on your shelf for a while? How can you lay the Bible down? It doesn't matter if you're in Genesis. Doesn't matter if you're in Habakkuk. Doesn't matter if you're in John. Come on now. Doesn't matter if you're in Acts. Doesn't matter if you're in 1st, 2nd Thessalonians. Don't matter. Don't matter if you're in the book of Revelation, the closing of the book. There's a message. There's life. And it's more abundantly. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, I'm convinced of this. I'm convinced that everybody needs help. Everybody needs direction. Everybody needs healing. Everybody needs a better job. Everybody needs something. And we're looking for answers. I've never met the amount of people that I have recently that are dissatisfied with their jobs. And some of you are going to think he's talking about me. No, I'm not talking. I'm just preaching. Don't take it personal. But I've never met the people, and it's a numerous amount of people that is telling me and others as well, that, you know, my job ain't what it used to be. The place I work, it's not what it used to be. And, you know, people are just terrible, and they say terrible things, and they do terrible things. And you know, I have a word today for you. Please receive this. You only see the devil when you're close to God. Uh-oh. I'm trying to tell you something. As you pursue God, as you run after God, as you go after God and you get in this word, if any man be in Christ, you see, some of you are on the same job that you worked when you was a sinner, but now you're a Christian. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Woo! The devil can't handle that new creature stuff. Come on, somebody help me this morning.
old things are passed away. My Lord, he's just not one in the bunch anymore, but he's done been separated and set apart. Oh, he's got something on him. He's got something on him that's going to win other people, and that's why the devil's mad. Come on now. You know, we need God's word to just speak into us, and that's what I wanted to do for the next few minutes. He says, old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. I want to give you a truth statement. You ready for truth? The Bible says, by the truth and what? Thank you. How many of us know that? If you can get truth, it's valuable. How valuable is truth? Truth will what? Thank you. Those are simple lessons, but they're lessons that we need to learn. If the word says buy it and sell it not, and then if it says truth is what sets you free, why don't we just adhere to the word of God? Adhere to the word of God. If any man be in Christ. What does that mean? That means that that man was a sinner, that woman was a sinner. That means that they were drawn to the Lord by the drawing of the Spirit. That means that out of their own mouth they confessed. With their own heart they believed. And God was faithful and just to forgive them. And because of that, they are a new creature. Woo! And that process of life has begun. I'm telling you, it's wonderful. There's nothing like being in ministry than being able to be around people that's got saved and hunger for God, and they're just looking and listening. Woo! What you got next, God? Woo! Some of you that gets tired of hearing preaching because you've been hearing it for 40 years, woo, just scoot over a little bit. Let somebody just got saved listen. Come on, somebody. I might get ugly this morning. But listen to me. There are hungry people that need the Word of God. There are people that still get excited when somebody open the Bible and read it and preach it and teach it. Woo! I'm telling you, that's preaching right there. That's what's going to change the world we live in when the Word of God, hallelujah, is preached and taught and spoke. Praise be to God. Let's not be afraid and let's not be ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power. You know what it is. Do you love Him this morning? My Lord, if you want to change and if you want to grow, stay in the Word. Stay in the Word. I recently got calls from people that would say things like, tell me something good I can read. Tell me a place that I can go and I can study in the Bible. And believe it or not, I have in my memory bank some places. But most often when somebody asks me that, I say, well, give me just a little time. Let me pray. Let me make sure. I want to lead you in the right direction. Because you're hungry. And you're tender, and I want to give you word that will nurse you and grow you. Because, you know, there's some stories in the Bible even hard for me to understand. Come on now. Man, if I just opened up in Leviticus and got to reading and studying that, Lord have mercy. It's good, and it's powerful. But, you know, for a new convert, somebody that's learning, somebody that's listening, and somebody that's growing, let's find some choice. Let's find some milk of the Word. And let's give it to them and feed them. Here's a true statement. We don't want to be who we are. And we will try all sorts of things to change. That's truth. We're unhappy with ourselves. A lot of times when it appears you're unhappy with everybody else, it's really, in reality, you're unhappy with yourself. And we don't want to be who we are, and therefore we'll try all sorts of things to change. Where can you find true happiness? Listening to your Father. Listening to the voice of God. Listening to the words of life that change you. Listen to this. Truth is, most of the time, we really want to just change the outside. Oh, yeah. Boy, I see people all the time trying to renovate themselves. If you don't believe it, You go online, you Google this. I done learned how to Google, so I look up this stuff. But you go on there and you Google how much money is spent every year with people having face work done and all kind of work done. They're 70 years old, but they're wanting to look 40. Come on now. I didn't come to preach to you. I come to talk to you. Tell you the truth. Truth is that money won't buy some things. Truth is there are doctors out there that can do an incredible job with people in reconstruction. People that's been in wrecks or accidents or tragedies, and the doctors can fix them. But if you're just looking for man to fix you and make you look young or feel young, come on, somebody. You put a 20-year-old face on an 80-year-old body, you still got it. I'm sorry. Wouldn't it be nice if we could go online and they do this now? I have a friend that's in pharmaceutical sales. And this guy's job, here's what he does. When surgery is taking place, when surgery is happening in knee replacement and hip replacements and so on, bone replacements or whatever, this guy actually represents a company that supplies those parts and materials to do that. But it's such a high interest thing that you just don't put that on UPS and send it. You know what I'm saying? So delivery is important. That's the reason God wants to work on you, and he don't want everybody else working on you, because God knows how delicate you are, and God wants to fix your problem, and God wants you to know everybody else don't have your answer, but God wants you to know he does. Because when those companies make a hip for a person, they have to size that hip completely to fit that person. And it has to be precise, and everything has to be perfect in that sense. And that's what I'm telling you this morning. Some of us needs that touch of God that changes us and fixes us. And God help me this morning, my Lord. The surgeon is standing by. Yes, the master surgeon. Oh, yes, the great physician is standing by, ready to perform surgery and do work on you this morning. My Lord, do you love him? Read this story this week. There was a man that owned a large warehouse. He was a number of years old. He was selling this, and he had taken a possible buyer to the property to show the property. Because the building was so old, because the building had set in what I would call a rural area in a big city, the building had took on some damage, you know, weather damage or whatever. But also, gangs or different related people had went by and took occasion to bust the windows. You ever drove by a real old building, all the windows been broke out? Why does people think just because it's an old building, you just break the windows out? You ever thought that building belongs to somebody? Somebody owns that building, and it's their building. It's old, it looks old, it's run down, but hey, it's their building. You don't have the right to go by and bust those windows out. But this man went, took this buyer, potential buyer, to this building and showed him this building, and he said to him, in embarrassment, here's what he said to him. He said, now, don't pay attention to all the broken window panes and all the damage that you see done, because I'm going to fix all that before I sell it to you. Buyer said, well, that won't be necessary. He said, don't worry about that. That's not what I'm here for. He said, well, I don't understand. I thought you wanted to purchase my building. I thought you wanted my building. And it's run down. And the windows are broke. The doors are damaged. The roof is bad. Don't worry about fixing the building, sir. It's not your building I want, it's the site. Because as soon as I buy and sign the paper, I'm going to tear this old building down. Some of you are going to get it in a minute. You see, when God shows up, he don't have a box of Band-Aids and iodine and all that stuff. Yeah. You see, we fix it, people. We have that imagination that, hey, it looks old, but let me do a little work on it and it'll look good. Bible says it's not that that goes in that divides, but it's that that comes out. This man that was wanting to buy this property was not looking for an old tore-down building, an old dilapidated building. His things was what he saw beyond the old. Woo, I'm finna get excited. And he saw what the new could look like. You see, it already had an architect to draw him up a set of plans, and he didn't even tell the man till later, but he already had what the new would look like before he ever bought the old. Somebody help me this morning. I'm telling you, God is always in control. Remember, it doesn't matter how you come, it's how you leave that matters. It matters how and what God does in reference to your life. I'm telling you, you may have some broke pieces and parts, and you may look dilapidated and worn out, but God has plans. Woo! Let God renovate and refurbish and do great and mighty things because he's God. He's God. Say he's God. Say he's God. And the story went on to say after the man bought the property, all he wanted was the site. Didn't care about the old building. He bought the property. Years down the road, the gentleman that had sold the property went back to his amazement. It's amazing what dreaming and having visions. Old man shall dream dreams, young man shall see visions. It's amazing what you can see in the spirit realm when you believe and see. And this man had a vision of building something. And you can drive around Tuscaloosa, my Lord. How many of you notice where old landmarks used to be in downtown Tuscaloosa now have become building sites to hotels and condominiums? See, somebody's always wanting to buy and change and all of this, but nobody paid a greater price to purchase than God. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. He sent his Son not into the world to condemn the world, but through him the world could be saved. I got to thinking last night, Shane, about all the change that I've saw in my ministry, in my life. And I remember growing up, and I've seen things, you know, in reference to people, in reference to the way people lived and their lifestyles, and I've watched, spiritually speaking, I've watched God buy and purchase and rebuild. And my message today was this, buy, purchase, and rebuild. But nobody does it like God. You see, he loved you when you was a sinner. He bought you. Come on. He purchased you because he has plans. You know, for you to degrade God in the sense that you would say, I'm a nobody and I'm a nothing, you know, you need to wipe your glasses off. They're fogged up. Sometime when I'm trying to read, Lord have mercy, I got to wipe clean and spit polish and all that stuff. Some of you don't know nothing about that. Some of you old enough to know that there was a time in your life when you didn't have running water and y'all took spit baths. Did I have to bring that up? Oh, Lord. Let me tell you something. Quit telling the Creator. Quit telling the Lord of Lords and King of Kings. Quit telling him that there's nothing here. There's people on the sound of my voice this morning. You, just because you failed, just because everybody else's books failed, because everybody else's advice has failed in your life, you're going to sit there and compare God with everybody else. You're going to say, well, Joe down the road told me, you know, he's been telling me for years all this, and Sally's been telling me for years, and I've been reading all these books, and I've been watching all these motivational tapes and all this stuff and all that stuff, and really I'm not much better off than I am. I was. But one night with a king. One touch to him is all it takes. When you think about the lady with Israel blood, what do you think about? One touch. That I might touch him. You know, sometimes man rules things out. And sometimes man says, well, you know, things ain't going to get no better. Things ain't going to be no better. That's not what the book says. You won't find failure in this book. Did you hear me? You won't find give up. Life and death is in the tongue, in the power of the tongue. Why don't we be more cautious and careful about how we say things if we're referring to this? This is not just a book. This is not a motivational speaker's book. This is God, Creator. Come on, somebody. Reggie Dabbs, to me, is one of the greatest motivational speakers that I've ever heard. I mean, he challenges me. He encourages me every time I hear him. First time I heard him was at a Winterfest. You might have been there. You might have heard what I heard. In case you didn't, I want to tell you. When I heard his testimony for the first time, here's what he said. Now, it was after he had spoke, and my, what a powerful word this man brings from God. Speaks to thousands of young people at a time. I'm talking 20, 30, 40,000. And reaches their heart. And this is an older guy. This is not a young person. But this is a man that has experienced change. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old thing passed away, behold, all things become new. I don't know why he saved this to later in his message. Maybe he thought, you know, he needed to go forward with the word and all this. And I mean, he had the crowd just, I mean, we were about ready to sprout wings and fly out of that place. I mean, he was just motivating us and he was encouraging us, but it was all word-based, all word-based. It was powerful. But he said, I need to share this testimony with you guys. He said, my life was all about this. He said, I'm the product of a $20 bill. A $20 bill. He said, I was a product of lust and sex and everything that was wrong, nothing right. If any man be in Christ, I don't care how your life starts. I don't care what the devil's telling you, and I don't care what you've been through. I'm telling you, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. God's all about new, Brother Ed. He's all about new. Let God visit your sight today. And I want to promise you, he'll be like the buyer of the property. He's not going to argue about the damage on the building. He's not going to argue that the windows are broke out and the doors are bashed in and the roof's leaking. He's not going to argue about all that, Ward. He's going to buy you just like you are because he's got plans for you. There's somebody on the sound of my voice this morning. The Lord told me to tell you this morning when I was praying. The Lord told me to tell you he has plans for you. He has plans for you. I ever search and look, saith God, for those that have become broken, that have become desolate, that have become degraded. I look for those that I might purchase and buy, that I might change, and they'll never look the same. I died for those that have been broken by the sins of this world, that I might purchase them and restore them and give them life more abundantly, saith God. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Adam can play. And every head bowed and every eye closed. Do you know how much God loves you? More than you can imagine. Would you be willing this morning? Would you be willing this morning to meet God at this altar and let Him show you how much He loves you? Would you be willing this morning to make a step that will literally change your life? Your life will never be the same. If today you would come down and you would be willing to say, Lord, here I am, just the way I am, broken. My windows are broke out. My doors are bashed in. I've got leaks in my life. God, I need healing, but I come to You. Come to You, Lord. This altar's open. Would you come right now? Would you just make that bold decision? It's a bold decision. It takes a lot on your part. But why would you be willing to remain where you are or to remain the same? How much does God love you? He loves you even though you haven't always been a good person and you haven't treated people good. But God loves you enough to forgive you and to heal you and to restore you and to bring peace in your life. Who else am I talking to? This altar's open. Why don't you today say, today I truly want to make a change. I've heard the message. I've heard the word. But I know today that the Lord is looking for a sight that He can purchase. Looking for a life that He can buy and change. And I want to be that person today. Is there anybody else? Every head bowed, every eye closed. I'm lost, Brother David, and I need to be saved. Would you come right now? Why would you not hear my voice, saith God? For as others would speak, I speak. And my voice is the most powerful voice there is. When I speak on your behalf. I let you know that I'm calling you home. As a father would call a prodigal son. And as a father of a prodigal son would wait for the arrival of the son, saith God, I wait on you. I wait on you today. I wait on you to come. I wait on you to come to me today. The only thing left for you to do is leave where you are and come home. Because I am your Father and I'm waiting on you, saith God. You say, Brother David, I'm not saved. I want to be saved. Would you come? Brother David, I'm not sure. I'm not where I need to be, and I need to make some adjustment. I need to make some changes. I need to rededicate myself. Would you come? Don't live another day like you're living. Many, many people live with the assumption that they'll have tomorrow or next week or whenever. Listen to me. Today is an important day. It's the day that God is calling you. And would you come? Anybody, would you come? Right now, I need to pray. You say, I need to pray. In the name of Jesus. I come because you're my answer, God. You're my answer. And I come to you. Anyone else? I would invite you, if you'd like to come around these altars, pray, help pray for these. We're going to end the service like this. I want you to be reverent, and I want you to respect this time that we got going on, this prayer that we're doing, and I want you to. If you have to leave, I understand, but listen, let's give God some time in prayer this morning. Would you do that? Father, we love you this morning. We thank you this morning. You're gracious and kind and never overlooking us. And always looking for us, God. You would never leave us and never forsake us. But it's your plan and purpose, God, to touch us and restore us. And I love you this morning, God, because I have come to realize and know your love. There's no love like your love. There's no love like your love, God. There's no mercy like your mercy and your grace. There's no mercy and grace like yours. And we need to show mercy and kindness and goodness to those around us. God, help us to have a Christ-like spirit. Help us to live a Christ-like life. Help us to be compassionate, kind toward other people, and realize the brokenness and realize, God, the state of people's lives and pray for them. Pray for the lost. Pray for the discouraged. Pray for the broken in heart. Pray for the sick. Pray for those that just simply needs encouragement and uplifting. Father, direct us. Give us direction every day. Let us go, God, accordingly to your word, as your word would speak, as your word would direct. And God, as people cry out, God, in their hungerness and desire to hunger and thirst after you, fill God. Fill them up, God, with your goodness and your mercy. And God, just use us for your glory. I pray, God, for the peace of Jerusalem. I pray for the peace of the world and the peace of America. But I pray for peace right here locally, God. Would you go into the homes and lives of those that are troubled today because of the loss of a loved one or the sickness of a family member or the problems that a family's facing, God? Would you go into their families? Would you go, God, to their place now? Minister and touch them, God. Minister to them, Father. Send, God, word says we don't have 4 months. We're to pray to the Lord of the harvest that he'll send forth labors. Send labors, God. Send labors is our prayer. In our faith, would you stand with us? Is our prayer, God. We love you this morning, Jesus. We love you, Lord. Woo. We love you, Lord. Who do you have on your mind, on your heart this morning? You got somebody on your mind, your family member, your friend that's lost or hurting? How about call them today, encourage them? How about pray for somebody today, encourage them? God bless you. We love you. Don't forget, tonight is our family enrichment night. Starts earlier, so don't forget. Please come. Let's have a great night together. God bless you.